organic artistic community.
Unique, friendly, high quality.
It was good. Yeah.
Welcoming, fun, potential.
Exciting, young, artistic.
Diversity, vibrancy, creativity.
Yeah, it was empowering. Exciting. I had a great night. I felt really excited. And yeah, it's exhilarating.
Absolutely fucking inspiring.
Youthful, bridging, and enthusiastic.
Community, eclectic, and motivational.
Cozy, enjoyable, nice.
Speaking of ukuleles, then, you know, I'm a big fan of a little guy called John Lennon, okay? He's a great guy. I don't know if any of you have heard of him, probably might not. He's a great guy. My favourite song by him is, of course, Imagine. And I'd like to do a sort of little rendition of that for you guys. This is Imagine by John Lennon. What? Sorry, Danny? Have you got a question there? No. No? You sure? Good. Man, I can't go on now. It's a bit rude now, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? I just think, do you want to get it out? Do you want to... No? I really want to know. It's just I can't go on until... You fine? Just tough crowd, really are. This is Imagine by John Lennon. Again, I mean, what's happening now?
Is anyone else thinking Stephen Lynch? I'm expecting a lot of swearing.
It's just Imagine by John Lennon. I mean, I'll play it in a minute, but I mean, if we're going to stop and then have a talk, I mean, I'm happy to do that, but... No, okay. I mean, all or nothing. Either get involved or don't, you know? I mean, it's not... Nah, I'll be fine. Okay, right. Okay, so like I said, I'm just going to... what song was I going to do? Imagine by John Lennon. This is... okay. I've messed up the call. I have to do the intro again. Sorry, guys. 17. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you're an atheist. Thank you very much, gotcha.
Well, the whole point, largely the whole point of the building and digging was to involve the creative community in whatever they wanted to do. So basically that.
Yeah, I think it's partly to enable sort of things to happen. Voicebox being one of the ideas that came across our sort of range of vision. But also the fact that it you know, it encourages people to get involved and participate, and drives a consistent audience really through the gallery. You know, it's important for us as well.
For me, first and foremost, it was about bringing a platform for local talent to sort of come along and share their work and sort of allow the artistic community in Wrexham to grow a little bit more. And I'd been to similar events in other places and seen how well they went down and seen how much community spirit there was. And for a while I felt that that was something that Wrexham could do with. So whilst I was setting up Voicebox, the entire idea was to allow a place where people could feel comfortable to come along and share their work.
I brought a knife to this bear fight and I'm going to win it, skin it, pin it, wear it tight to my flesh, and then I'm going to strike a man armed with a knife and question whether I was ever fighting anybody in the first place. Give a wide berth for my first pace into an empty room. A wise word bursts from the abyss and then consumes the space. Creep on, misplaced. Keep on, distaste. Sleep long, no haste. I stalk the silence and resume the dredging journey, edging forward through the violence, tuned to timeless discordance, little ordinance, no coordinates, yearning for direction, turning on constant misconceptions of self. The hamster wheel is tiring. The smell of burning rubber fires my nostrils as I tread this tire ring. Dire strings of doubt sting our dour idiosyncrasy, but still the tire ring sings to me, spinning in synchrony, in sync with these sinking dreams. I blink, it seems. I think too much. Thank you.
Meeting other people who are interested in the arts, especially those who write poetry like me, but musicians too, stand-up comedians, and the variety of everything that they have to offer.
Voicebox and events like this are an essential part of keeping poetry alive. It's great to have work published, it's great to see books and big literary festivals, but this is the grassroots of poetry where people can get out, they can try out poetry, they can meet other poets. They are the lifeblood of poetry in Wales, and I was so loved being part of this event this evening. It was brilliant.
After organising and attending a couple hundred events over the last, you know, 4 or 5 years, it has to be the sort of the communal feeling, the feeling of doing something together and finding intense experiences, experiencing some very, very powerful artistic and you know, verbal things, you know. The consequences that bring people together is something that brings joy to me every single time, whether I'm hosting or just, you know, enjoying the night, you know, as a spectator.
The vibe, which was amazing. Everyone was mega friendly and super cool. The space is incredible. Like, everything about this event was really cool. There's a soundbite for you, but everything was dope. Everything was really good, but the vibe and the uniqueness of the mix of characters forming and the space, I think, was really, really great.
I like the social side of it. I think the mix that Tim has here is good. Age groups and also different styles. So it's like a melting pot, really, of ideas.
I just think it's good for Wrexham because Wrexham hasn't got many many cultural events, and I think having an open mic for poetry is really different, and so far it's going down really well.
What I like the most about it is just seeing just new branches of art and people expressing themselves, and I think it's a well-presented, nice, easy-going event.
Events like Voicebox certainly give us all a chance to get out and share our work, and which is really important, and I like to try and get down as many as I can. So yeah, it's the sharing aspect is brilliant.
I enjoy the sort of togetherness of an event like this, in that sort of people who attend these events are all in a similar mindset. They all want to come along and have a good time. There's no sort of competitive nature. Everyone wants to come and just share the experience of having a more open nature to yourself, in that everyone is sharing a piece of work that's likely to be fairly personal to themselves. So having an environment where people are able to come along and sort of open themselves and have a more social aspect to their night.
They're different every time. I mean, partly that's what I love about poetry, is everywhere you perform is going to be slightly different. But I think events like this, where you have such a varied open mic and you have people coming up and doing it for the first time and, you know, reading it off their phone, and an atmosphere that doesn't put those people off. And you have people who have apparently been banned from churches and whatever. And everyone is given the same opportunity and welcomed with the same kind of stance from the beginning. And I love that. And there's people who come back for the fifth time and read again, and everyone welcomes them and makes them feel like there's support, and that can only grow and nurture.
I like people. I like some paper people. They'd be purple paper people, maybe pop-up purple paper people, proper pop-up purple paper people. How do you prop up proper pop-up purple paper people? I hear you cry. Well, I probably proper pop-up purple paper people with the proper pop-up purple people paper clip, but I pre-prepare appropriate adhesives as alternatives to cheek packet, which is because paper slipped, because I could build a pop-up metropolis. But I wouldn't want to deal with all those paper people, politics, paper politicians with their paper-thin policies, broken promises without appropriate apologies. There'd be a little paper me and a little paper you. And we could watch paper TV and it would all be pay-per-view. We'd see those poppy paper wraps rub about the paper package, or watch paper people carriers get stuck in paper traffic on the A4. Paper. There'd be a paper Princess Kate, but we'd all stare at paper Pippa. And we'd all live in fear of Killer Jack the Paper Ripper, because the paper propaganda propagates to people's prejudices. Paper's printed pictures of the footage and it terrorists. It's a little paper me and a little paper you, and in a pop-up populations, people's problems pop up too. There'd be that pompous paper parliament who remained out of touch and ignored the people's protests about all the paper cuts, and then the peaceful paper protests will get blown to paper pieces by the confetti cannons, by preemptive police, and yes, there'd still be paper money, so there'd still be paper greed. And the paper piggy bank is putting them in that they need, purchasing the proper breed to pepper the paper properties. Others live in poverty and unacknowledged properly, a proper poor economy with so many a proper poor, but while the needs get ignored, the money goes to big wars. Origami armies unfold plans for paper planes, and we remain imprisoned by our own paper chains, but the greatest shame is that it always seems to stay the same. What changes is who's in power, choosing how to lay the blame, then naming names, forgetting these are names of people. Because in the end, it all comes down to people. I like people, because even when the situation's dire, it's only ever people who were able to inspire, and on paper, it's hard to see how we all cope. But in the bottom of Pandora's box, there's still hope, and I still hope, because I believe in people. People like my grandparents, who every single day since I was born have taken time out of their morning to pray for me. That's 8,672 days straight of someone checking I'm okay, and that's amazing. People like my aunt who puts on plays with prisoners. People who are capable of genuine forgiveness. People like the persecuted Palestinians. People out of their way to make your life better and expect nothing in return. You see, people have potential to be powerful. Just because the people in power tend to pretend to be victims, we don't need to succumb to that system. And a paper population is no different. So there's a little paper me and a little paper you. And in a pop-up populations, people's problems pop up too. Even if the whole world fell apart, then we still make it through. Because we're people.
I enjoy performing because it's an opportunity to show what I do. I mean, that sounds really egotistic, and it's not just about me making myself feel important and standing in front of everyone and having everyone's attention, but it is partly about me showing my work. So I spend time writing and I try my hardest to make it as good as I can, but it only becomes real when I share it. It's not just about me and my own thoughts, it really is about sharing it. And then when I share that, it becomes a conversation, and the feedback I get from that conversation is where the real development happens for me. So it's like a big mirror for me to look at myself in. That's the first motivation. After that, if people in the audience experience something that they enjoy or they find inspiring or they have a good feeling from it, then that's the real payback. To try and make people have a meaningful experience is a great, great thing, and I love that.
The live performance of written work allows the space to explore and express the atmosphere that surrounds it. As both writer and performer, you can edit on the spot and adapt your work to the audience, which is pretty cool.
I think it's just enjoyable, and it's kind of, and when you get, you know, when you say it out loud, you kind of get an instant reaction. You kind of get people to, you know, you get instant feedback kind of thing when you do it in front of people. And it's that kind of hit or miss sort of thing. You know, if it doesn't go down very well, then you would know instantly know about it. And you kind of have a lonely ride home. But, you know, when it goes well, on the odd occasion, then, you know, you get that instant feedback. And you know that you've kind of instantly made people laugh and you've instantly kind of given them a good feeling. So I think it's that kind of that instant reaction sort of thing.
I think the most exciting thing is the nerves before you perform, because that's when you start really thinking about a piece, and when you say it out loud, a poem takes on a completely new meaning. It's an oral experience, I think, and so to read out the poem out loud, you get that instant response from the audience, and you can revise the poem then in the knowledge that you've said it. I think that's important with poetry.
As an attention seeker, it's quite good to have a room of people looking at me and having a microphone so they have to listen to me. That's good. And also, lots of artists in one place, right? Awesome.
I enjoy the reaction, like. That's what I do it for. I'm not interested in writing anything down at all, ever. All I want to do is see people's reactions. A lot of my poems, like, once I've got them memorised, I'll never read them again. Because I just adapt them to people's reactions in the crowd.
Performing work aloud, I guess, it's just I can focus on the repetition and sort of playful elements of my own work a little bit, sort of play on things from stand-up comedy and create that kind of comedic response from an audience. You can also do that to create different emotions as well. But that's the main thing that I enjoy about reading and sort of performing spoken word.
Yeah, what do I enjoy about reading and performing? It's me, I just do it, I've been doing it that long. If I open the fridge, I take a bow. So the light comes on. And, so yeah, it's part of what I do now.
It's quite, it's the camera, hello camera.
Sorry.
It's all right, don't worry, hello camera. It's quite personal. I think that's what I like most about it. It's something you can share without any kind of veil behind it. Music's nice, music's a good way to do it, but you're still kind of hiding behind the music a little bit, so I'm quite exposing. Like saying, just saying your thoughts to people. Yeah.
To make people laugh is great and is a good thing to do, I think. And I think if I didn't do it, although I started at 32, it's something I hope I keep doing because I just enjoy it so much. I do.
I just enjoy seeing people's reactions, really. Like, I enjoy doing it because it's just a way to express myself, so. I don't know, I prefer to do it through music than through words, even though words can be music. Yeah.
They lurk in the dark, eyes closed and it starts, never to be seen, but still make the dogs bark. They grab you by the hand, and when the shivers come, you know it's Shadow Man. They lurk in the dark, eyes closed and it's last. Never to be seen, still make the dogs growl. You hark and they plant, they grab you by the hand. And when the shivers come, you know what Shadow Man.
Because I found out it existed, mainly. Essentially, I'd started writing, and my ex-girlfriend had taught me into performing into a poetry slam in Manchester. And it occurred to me that there was a week to go before this slam, and I never performed in front of anyone ever. And I just so happened to see this sign for Voicebox when I was DJing here a week before. So I thought I'd better at least have a go performing once before doing it.
Yeah.
Which led to a beautiful relationship.
Well, I didn't perform at the very first one. But after seeing how other people how people reacted to the performances they were and how friendly the atmosphere was, I felt more comfortable to perform my own work because I felt like it would be, it'd be appreciated.
I wasn't comfortable at all at first. I was shaking. It was just once I got into the rhythm and realised everyone else was in the same position as me, that I slowly relaxed and been able to get through it.
It's clearly a room filled with open-minded individuals who just like to hear what you've got to come up with, basically.
Well, in fairness, it's just, I think, it's a room full of artists, isn't it? So no one's here to judge each other, it's just purely trying to help each other along better, and there's just sort of collaboration, I guess. But also, awesome menu, and again, I just really like having attention on me, so that was good. Shall I do one more button? Will I make it? Should we leave it here? Should we finish the interview like this? Should we just, is this good?
Because it's a friendly atmosphere, and people are generally very welcoming, and just help you with your performance.
Out of depth, out of step with the rest of the world, taking it left, right, left. I hold my breath in the hope I end up in proficient where I compose a threat. I propose no editing, I mold my text and me more than dressing slick to so regret. Take a vow of celibacy more, protect you from me ever being fucked on this noble quest. Music means something more to me, wakes me up from a moment's sleep, a volcano's dormancy, but I flow more like a storming sea, and I just can't conform to be. Another ace in the pack, placed in the back, facing it like a game time, running on a track at the same time, that I'm getting rings run round me. This web's profounding and it's spun round me. And I don't want to go local, but I want to be somewhere else than just local. I want to go postal, in every postal address, address the issue internationally, until they chant for me, grabbing me, until I land in sea. Embracing the waves that the ocean hands to me, this captaincy, my only form of vanity. Cheers!
The fact that it's in fucking Wrexham, and nothing else is.
I think what is different here is the youth, and that's great because it's going to carry on and it's handed over to a new generation.
Well, I've only ever been to open mic night events, and obviously it's different in that there's more poetry, and I'd never been to a poetry event until I'd gone to Voicebox, and then I found out that I really enjoyed it, and that's where I keep going.
For me, it sort of starts with the fact that it's in Wrexham. There hasn't been a great deal of sort of these mixed media cultural events going on. So having a space where people can share varied sort of pieces of work, they can come along, they can do a piece of drama, they can come along and just rant at people if they want to, they can come share a piece of poetry, they can come and sing. The fact that there is this absolute variety with a focus on spoken word, sort of set it aside from other events I've been to where it is more specific to one field. It's either singing, it's either poetry, it's sort of, this one has a bit more of an open aspect to it.
The international cultural exchange. So it's the first time that I've done a live video feed performance, and it's the first time I've performed in Wales. So the sensation of being in two places at once, in two hemispheres at once, sets Voicebox aside for me personally.
I think Voicebox is different from other events, mainly because it is so comfortable. I think it feels like a group of, to me it feels like a group of peers who are you know, sort of supporting each other. People really listen to what each performer is saying. You know, there's nobody talking over people when they're on stage. And I get, you know, you can almost feel the support that's sort of coming out from people. You know, when people get it wrong or a bit nervous, you know, you really feel that the crowd are behind them. I think sometimes with acoustic nights, you know, there's a bit of competition and a bit of an edge there, but I didn't feel any of that to be true for this book.
No, that's very true. That's good. Yeah, and the word peers is interesting because, you know, socially, maybe perhaps not, because some people are a lot older than some of the people, but everyone, yeah, has got, it's a good spirit. Everyone's got together.
Well, the most important thing is that it's based in Wrexham. Wrexham's the biggest town in North Wales, and it needs to punch its weight in the arts, and Voicebox helps Wrexham to do that.
It's just very different because it promotes everyone's uniqueness, and everyone and anyone can come to this, and it's got a wide variety of people and performers.
In many ways, the diversity of ages, and I think that it offers an opportunity for people to try out new stuff. Tonight I'm going to read poems that I've never read before, and I think you've got the confidence to do that because you're amongst friends, you're amongst people who will accept it and give critique and suggestions. Whereas very often when you are performing in places, you think you've got to put almost like your best poem on, or like you dress up for events, you know, and I think here you can just be yourself and play around with ideas.
The important thing is that Voicebox is producing an event that's easily of the same standard as events that I've been to in Cardiff or Liverpool and London, and that's what we need to see in Wrexham. We need to see this level of professionalism and this level of poetry that's coming up through the open floor as well.
I've done quite a lot recently. Like, I've been on tour and been supporting bands and stuff on tour, and then doing different spoken word nights. I guess it's just different in the sense that, like, it's in Wrexham. I guess that's quite obvious, but I think it's important to have an event like this in Wrexham. Looking around at these walls in this venue, like, there's lots of art on the wall. It's important to have like art in sort of this community, really, and I think, like, yeah, I just think it's important to have that art there, and so that people can listen and share their work as well.
I bet Banksy walks around in an I Am Banksy slogan t-shirt all day, every day. This is your life, and it's ending one DVD box set at a time. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Every time Bane talks, a glass at the local pub shatters. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Every time Bane talks, a tree falls down outside. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Every time Bane talks, a neighbor thinks God is talking. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Every time Bane talks, a snow globe gets snowy. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Every time Bane talks, the cat next door loses a life. I'm at my parents' house. Dad is watching Dark Knight Rises with surround sound. Parrots in a 4-mile radius now all sound like Bane. Elvis Costello, legend. Elvis Costello is the man. Elvis Costello is a man. Hey, news just in, I've retired from football. The tie rack in Piccadilly Station is closing down. That last one is just factual, so. Cool.
I definitely think it sort of gives it some sense of individuality. The fact that it's in a pop-up art space gives it a whole new nature in that there's nothing to distract you that isn't artistic. Whereas if you've had it in, say, a pub or a theatre, then sometimes you've got like a loud ventilation system for one, or you could have someone playing pool in the background, which is irritating when you're trying to sort of pay your whole attention to someone who's sort of reading their poem that they've been working on for 6 months for all you know. So having the art around you means that you're able to listen to the person performing whilst looking at things that other artists from in the nearby area have contributed to the same space.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost reminds you a bit of the Edinburgh Festival, where Bob Slayer, he's a bit of a lunatic comedian, alternative, he's keeping that alternative thing going from Malcolm Hardy days, from punk, it's almost the punk of comedy still going, and he hired a shop. There was a shop he rented for the whole run. He did. That was the venue. It was a shop. And it reminded me of that. And you go in and you have discussions and all sorts of different things. And it's good. Good.
I think they have a great novelty factor, which I think helps sort of attract people to them. It's not like holding something in a pub or a bar, which is a bit more traditional, or theatre spaces or, you know, community centres. And I think with Degeen and 3B, you know, we do have quite a strong focus on arts in general. And I think with that in mind, I think it helps to be part of that. You know, I think spoken word is one part of a greater whole that includes music, includes visual arts, film, etc. Really, you know, and it all comes together within that one place. I think, I mean, to my mind, that sort of helps with sharing audience and getting people interested, really, in the event.
Good.
But they're also flexible spaces, right? To be able to do lots of different stuff. You know, it is a space. Which is multi-purposed.
Actually, I do, because when I come in, it's always different. Now we have studio space being set up. The last time I came in, there was an exhibition that was here for a month that was all to do with retold tales and sort of spoken word stories. I think the feeling of flux really suits this type of event. And I haven't actually been to something like Voicebox around North Wales or Chester. I haven't seen anything else like this, so it's really important that it continues. City agrees.
Yeah, it definitely helps in the fact that there's an instant atmosphere as soon as you walk in the door, which is awesome. It's great that in the, like, on the high street there is an art space. It's amazing that what used to be a JJB is now an art space. Like, the fact that you couldn't have all these comfy chairs, like, whether or not they're actually comfy, I didn't test them all, but they look amazing. You've got this, like, you've got this, like, full-on lounge vibe in this quite, like, vacuous space. Which is super cool. So yes, I think it does help because it creates a sense of also ownership, I imagine. Like, obviously I've only come here today, but it must feel pretty awesome for a crew to be coming into a space that is being made, that you're making your own for that night. I think that's awesome.
I like the feel of it. I don't, it's hard to imagine, I've only seen it here, but it works with the sofas around and kind of coming up the weird elevator to what used to be a shop and kind of seeing it like this. I think it's, I would, to have a room this big and make it feel such a welcoming atmosphere without having 300 people in it, I think is very impressive. And that helps with the kind of pop-up vibes and chairs everywhere and, you know, sculptures made from duct tape and wires across the ceiling. I think it's cool.
Yeah, I think this is quite a unique space, and there's lots going on. So there's more than just Voicebox. There's the art side of it. There's usually an exhibition going on. There's music going on. There's a bar, which helps as well. So I think it's good venue.
I
don't go to church on Sunday. Don't get down on my knees to pray. No, 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 no. Don't memorize the books of the Bible, baby. I got my own special way. I know Jesus gonna love me, maybe just a little bit more, when I fall down on my knees every Sunday at the local candy store. It's gotta be a chocolate Jesus to make me feel good inside. Gotta be a chocolate Jesus keeping me satisfied. Now when it gets round a Good Friday, I know what it's gonna be. When they open up the Easter basket, it won't be chocolate eggs for me. Well, I'll put a bit of blue tack behind him, and I'll stick him up there on the cross, and pray to him every morning. I'll say, hey baby, you sure the boss, but it's gotta be a chocolate Jesus to make me feel good inside. Gotta be a chocolate Jesus keeping me satisfied. Now when the weather gets hot, it's a whiskey in the shade, and you gotta wrap your savior up in cellophane. If he melts like the muddy baby, that's all right. Pour him over ice cream for a heavenly delight. Yay! Whoa, 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 baby. Oh, oh, oh. I went to the store Sunday morning, looking for my special treat. The lady there behind the counter, she said, hey boy, what you gonna eat? Is it gonna be a Mars bar or Kit Kat? Tell me what you want from the store, 'cause they'll tell you about your chocolate Jesus. They're not making him anymore. I said, gotta be a chocolate Jesus to make me feel good inside. Gotta be a chocolate Jesus keeping me satisfied. Hey Lord up there, can you hear me? If you're sitting up there in the sky, come on, throw me down a chocolate Jesus, or else Lord, I'm just gonna
come along and see how it's done. That was always my kind of mentality when I started. I wanted to go to as many things as possible, because there'll be one of two things. Either you'll see someone incredible and be very inspired and you'll try and, you know, be as good as them, or you'll see someone who's awful and you'll think, I can be better. And that was how I started, and that's still what I do.
It's a very encouraging environment. This is the best place to do it. If you can't do it here, you can't do it anywhere. But if you do do it, and you do what, you'll feel better about yourself. Just do it for your own good.
Just write your work, and just do it. I mean, that sounds so cliche, but even if it's rubbish, even if it's awful, like, you just have to start doing it, and you'll get better. And no one's going to judge you. Like, it's a safe space. No, it's not. You know, everyone's really lovely, and if you don't start somewhere, then you can't improve, can you? You can't become really amazing if you don't start.
I would say, don't be afraid to try out new ideas. Don't think your ideas are too off the wall or too weird. Don't think you have to have a certain style to fit in, especially with spoken word. I think it's important that we see different rhythms and different cultures, different genders, all coming through. Because there's a danger with every art form for things to have a bit of a buzz and the same texture. And I think Voicebox is really good for breaking those things down a bit, but still coming across as a coherent whole.
Just do it. I don't know, that's a difficult question. Be confident, smile. I was told to just not be shit. That's the best advice that I've ever had. When I was kind of starting off stand up, I was speaking to people that were better at it, and the best advice was just to not be shit and just, you know, do what makes you laugh, and do something that you're proud of. I think only perform things that you're proud of, or things that you can justify yourself. Because if you don't find it funny yourself, then there's no point in performing it. So if it makes you laugh, even if it doesn't make them laugh in my case, then, you know, if you're performing for yourself really, rather than performing for other people, then you're going to become the sort of your own true artist kind of thing. So just kind of don't be shit.
Well, the nights are very friendly. I'd come along and I'd bring something along to read or to sing or whatever. Anything creative, bring it along and share it with some others.
I think it's not a closed shop, it's an open shop, so please come along and see what it's like for yourself, and if it's for you. And, you know, don't, you know, really, if you've got anything to contribute, don't sit on your poems, don't sit on your art, don't sit on your literature. You know, I think it's an open house. I think a lot of people are encouraged to perform. I think people enjoy performing for the first time, what I've witnessed. So I think, yeah, if you're into that sort of thing, or I'm just curious, please come along.
Sometimes people are terrified that everybody's going to be Caroline Duffy or Andrew Motion, but it's not like that. People want the best for you, and the audience is not there to shoot you down. They're there to encourage you and carry you through it.
Get off your arse and go. There's no point sitting at home. You need to do it. There's nothing else you can say, really. Either, you know, you've got to get to these events. There's no other way to explain it until you actually go. It's that simple.
Oh man, that depends on their motive for performing, but I would say do it, because nothing bad can really happen unless you like lose control of your bowels, do you know what I mean? And that's not up to the space, that's up to you. As long as you've got control of your biological functions, go and do it. That's what I'd say. Sound alright? Yo. I was in my late teens, getting kinda crazy with mates in the village where we play Chief daily. Skating day, sit, wait till the moon rays bathe, then hit that sid, get wavy. We chill and mess about in the deep night, stepping out, kicking out, mischief on mind. We were young in our time and the world owed us everything. All to prove, click cheap booze medicine. We chatting that thin flat rhetoric, swag around like we got caps, want feathers in. Jump fences when gates won't let us in. And that's a metaphor for many things around that time, and it's literal. Back to the time that I'm giving you. We're pissed drunk and we're chipper. Used to run gardens for giggles in little crews. The gang's kinda bigger than we're used to tonight. Jump ball and we move through, nothing unusual. Quiet as the light from the new moon. Hit the run, that was fun, nothing unusual. Toward. Now we jump last wall and we done, but it's mad narrow. There's a balcony between us and the ground, kind of narrow. Now we're right against a person's house. That's a patio window. Don't know if it's double glazed, so don't make a sound. Five of us are stood, adrenaline is sticking our mouths. And the sixth of our number does everything loud. As he creeps on the balcony, it creaks like a thunderclap. None of us breathe, like pin drop, mouse squeak, everything freeze. And we wait in a second as it stretches, wait in a second as it stretches, stretches. The
Curtains twitch twice and they're torn apart. A man in his pajamas stands froze to his carpet. Hearts are in our throats. His face is so close. See his breath on the glass and the glass is on his nose. He gives a start and we move so fast, like a school of fish sprinting through the streets, floating over cars, skidding over bonnets. No stopping till I spot round the back of budgeons running like goal legs at the crossroad. Gang of scallies gathered with their mopeds, 15 strong, and there's bad blood between us. Never quashed beef and we never made progress, just a part of weekend's process. They spill into the road like soup dodgers. We don't like your hair or your clothes. We got somewhere to be. Geezer might have called the police, so we slinging bees and keep steaming past. Their shouts drowning, our feet stomping. Then we're clear of them. Hear the whine of 50 cc's coming. Headlamps on us. Split up, sprint up to guard an edge and jump in. Head first, I'm behind a hedge, hearts pumping. Motorbikes prowl up and down the streets. I hear the engine and I see the lights. Someone opens the house's door. There's a man on his porch with a bat and a torch and a dog silhouetted. This is massive as a horse. And I'm waiting a second as it stretches. And I'm waiting a second as it stretches. Stretches, 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 stretches. That was to be continued. Cheeky little cliffhanger for y'all.
I hope it keeps going. I hope it continues to develop and grow. And I hope that more and more people in the Wrexham area come along, either as performers or, of course, as an audience. And performers are always crying out for an audience. So you don't have to come to Voicebox to perform. Come along and listen.
I just think you need to keep doing what you're doing, really. Just keep having that level of professionalism, that standard. Keep getting interesting guest poets in. It's a great format to have an open floor and then a guest poet, because that shows people what, you know, where they can work towards, and it also gives local people the opportunity to come out and see poetry that they wouldn't normally. So, yeah, just keep doing what you're doing. It's good, Matt.
Progression, as it has been, really. How long has it been going for now, is it?
A year and 5 months.
Yeah, so it's certainly progressed in that time. So, the same really, just to keep progressing.
I hope it draws more attention. Hope we get a lot more guest performers wanting to perform here. And just a bigger attendance. We want more people to come. We want more people to hear what other people have got to say.
I'd hope for it to expand. I want a bigger turnout, really. I want it to be successful, because it's not often that you get these type of events. So I think we should definitely showcase it.
To continue and go on from strength to strength. I love the fact that as I've been coming, I've been seeing more and more people come each time and doing more things with it, different guest speakers in different styles, different local performers for the open mic bit in different styles. And I'd love to see that increase and more people doing different things. Just for it to keep going on, really, and become more known so that everybody else can see what brilliant things are happening here in Wrexham.
I think we did the experimental one in terms of the international one last month. I'd like to see, looking at ideas like that, I guess, looking at experiments in terms of how we can go forward as a group. Mike says, they have been doing really, really well, and we obviously want that success to continue.
I hope that it continues to grow, because at the moment there are a lot of people that attend, but I do hope it gets bigger and more people feel comfortable enough to come along, see what the night's about, and then even feel comfortable enough to perform their own work.
For the future of Voicebox, I'd want it to keep going as it has been, because it's been successful so far. In that we've had, the first guest act we were able to name was a friend of mine, Martin Dawes, who is also the Young People's Poet Laureate for Wales. So if we're opening with a name like that, I'd hope to be able to continue in the same vein. Since then we've had Joseph Wynne, who's a local stand-up comedian who's sort of working his way up the ranks, so to speak. And we're yet to welcome Sophie McKean and Adam Camerling. So at the moment we're going strong, and I hope to sort of keep developing that. We've had an international night, which was sort of an experimental experience, which we think we did very well. So I'd hope to keep going as we are and maybe try and develop on that, so we end up with a larger audience, maybe bringing people from sort of more of the extended community, sort of from the surrounding areas, and just allow Voicebox to grow as it has been.
I hope it carries on in the same way, and the fact that it's monthly, I hope that that carries on, because there isn't another one that's monthly, I don't, as far as I know, in Wrexham itself, so that's excellent.
I think we definitely need to incorporate wrestling at some point. I'd like to see bare knuckle fighting between the poets.
I've never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. I know a lad who had both his ears bitten off in separate incidents 2 weeks apart. I know a psychopath who cried for weeks when his girlfriend broke his heart. I know a bloke who's into Breaking Bad and actually watched it at the start. But I've still never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. I know a girl who ends up pregnant on the first night she got kissed. I know a bloke who passed out getting the No Fear logo tattooed on his wrist. I know a bloke who drove to his drink awareness course with no license when he was pissed. But still, never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. I know a vinyl collector who thinks he's actually finished his collection. I know a lad on the sex offenders register who says he's never had an erection. I know a girl who always wears Slayer t-shirts and listens to One Direction. But never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. I know a lad who did smack in his freshers week and went on to be a priest. I know a grime MC who joined the EDL and said he only wanted peace. I know a bloke in his early 30s who's never tried pasta or cheese. Don't know anyone who hates Massive Attack. I know a bloke who drinks in Wrexham and avoids the chavvy places. I know a cop who investigates sexual assaults without taking the side of the rapist. I know a bloke who says, I'm not racist, but, and then doesn't say anything racist. Still, never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. I know a shop that still sells Freddos at the correct price of 10 pence. I know a bloke who posts stuff off the lad Bible who isn't actually that dense. I know a bloke in senior management who uses common fucking sense. Never met anyone who hates Massive Attack. And I know one bloke, just the one mind, who ran a triathlon without going on about it constantly on every form of social media, logging every trip to the gym, run and visit to the toilet on Facebook and Twitter with some gobshite Nike Plus app, and mithering people who've been avoiding him from high school with a just giving link for some shithouse charity that claims to be raising money for children in Paraguay that have never eaten focaccia bread or some shit. Although a cursory glance over the annual report suggests that most of the money is going in the back pocket of the chief executive officer, but I've never met anyone who doesn't like Massive Attack. Thank you.